हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम बैक टू ऑनलाइन लेक्चर सीरीज ऑन इंजीनियरिंग थर्मोडाइनेमिक्स। वी आर कंटिन्यूइंग अवर टॉपिक ऑफ एक्सर्जी। एज यूजुअल वी विल हैव सम रिवीजन ऑफ अवर प्रीवियस टॉपिक्स एंड देन वी विल बिगिन। In our previous lecture, we began with reversible work by an open system exchanging heat only with the surrounding. So here we are having this open system in which mass flow is entering and leaving the system, and it is only exchanging heat with the surrounding. So here we are also operating a reversible heat engine between surrounding and the system. So here we obtained the value of maximum work, that is d cut w max. This is the general expression for maximum work of an open system which exchanges heat only with surroundings at T0 and T0. The next topic was reversible work in steady flow process. For steady flow process, the mass flow rate is same and differential of U minus TS plus kinetic energy plus potential energy is zero. That is, it remains constant. So this is the modified maximum work, and here this yellow highlighted portion, that is H minus T0S, is called as Keenan function B. So we have simply replaced this with B, and here this whole for bracket, that is B plus mv square by 2 plus mgz, is known as availability function. Or if you see carefully, the summation of Keenan function plus kinetic energy plus potential energy is also known as availability function of a steady flow process. That is, psi is equal to b plus mv square by 2 plus mgz. So the important thing out of this is the definition of Keenan function and availability function, and these are unit mass basis values. And these are the modifications. The next theory was reversible work in a closed system. So obviously in closed system there is no mass exchange, so dm1 is equal to dm2 is equal to 0. So here we are only left with the third term, and these are the modifications and neglecting the kinetic and potential energy terms. So we are only left with w max as u1 minus u2 minus t0 s1 minus s2. This was already done in very earlier, so we are not going to repeat this. That is useful work we have done. And the only important thing is availability function for a closed system, which is given by u plus p0 v1 minus t0 s. So this is u plus p0 v plus minus t0 s is known as availability function. The next theory was maximum useful work obtainable when a system exchanges heat with TER in addition to atmosphere. So here for steady flow process as well as for closed system, the equations are written for useful work, and these are the modifications. And the last theory of our previous lecture was dead state. That is, whenever a system departs from that of surrounding, the state of the system departs from that of surrounding, an opportunity exists for producing a work. So whenever the system reaches the parameters of surrounding, this opportunity diminishes and it ceases to exist when two are in equilibrium. We have done detailed discussion on this. So any change in the state of the system from a dead state is a measure of availability of work that can be extracted from it, and all the spontaneous processes terminate at the dead state. So we have done this in our previous lecture, and now we will be beginning our new topic, that is availability. So let's begin. Whenever a useful work is obtained during a process in which a finite system undergoes a change of state, the process must terminate when the pressure and temperature of the system have become equal to the pressure and temperature of the surroundings, that is P0 and T0, that is when the system has reached its dead state. So here, whenever suppose we are having a system which is at 50 degrees Celsius and we are getting some useful work out of it, so the process of getting this useful work must terminate when it reaches that pressure and temperature of surrounding, let us say 25 degrees Celsius. So it has to reach at the dead state. The availability A of a given state is defined as, now this is the definition of availability, capital A is defined as the maximum useful work, that is total work minus PDV work, that is obtainable in a process in which the system comes to equilibrium with its surrounding. So the availability is defined as maximum useful work minus, that is maximum useful work that can be obtained. That is, it is a composite property depending upon the state of both the system and surrounding. So this is not only function of system, but this is a function, we can say is function of the parameters of system as well as the parameters of surrounding. Now we will see the value of availability in a steady flow process. Now the reversible maximum work associated with a steady flow process for a single flow is given by this formula. We have already studied this, that is Wmax is equal to the value of H minus T0, that was our Keenan function, plus kinetic energy plus potential energy at state 1 minus all the terms at state 2, that is this. With a given state for द मास एंटरिंग द सेवी द मैक्सिमम वर्क ऑब्टेनेबल वुड बी व्हेन दिस मास लीव्स द सेवी इन द इक्विलिब्रियम विद द सराउंडिंग्स. So, since there is no change in the control volume, no work is done on the atmosphere. So, let us designate the initial state of mass entering the CV with parameters having no subscript, and the final will be dead state because we need maximum work out of this. Final dead state of mass leaving CV with parameters having subscript 0. So here we are going to have only the thing that from, let us say, don't consider this as a system, but just for understanding purpose, here we are having a particular state which is different from environment or surrounding, and we are reaching to a dead state. And we are subscripting this as 0. So we will see this in equation. So we are having a simple process in which we are, the substance is at some state which is different from the surrounding, and it is going through a process in which at the end it is reaching the dead state, which will be designated as 0 subscript. The maximum work or availability A would be given by this formula, that is H minus T0S plus mv square by 2 plus mgz minus, here we are getting H0 minus T0S plus mgz0. If you see carefully, we don't have the kinetic energy term which is present over, which is not present over here, because the final velocity at dead state will be 0. Here psi is known as availability function. So here we have done this already in our previous lecture, but still we are repeating this part. So this is the function psi. That is known as availability function for a steady flow system in which there is no change in the volume, that is dv0 is equal to 0. Now the availability per unit mass, that is on unit mass basis, we can write down A as H minus T0S plus mv square by 2 plus gz minus. And so similarly, exactly the same thing is done over here, but the only difference is the entire equation is for unit mass basis. Now previously we were having only ending up in the dead state. Now let us say that if subscript 1 and 2 denote the states of the system entering and leaving the CV, the decrease in availability or the maximum work obtainable for a given system surrounding combination would be given by this formula, where W max is equal to A1 minus A2 is equal to Psi1 minus Psi2. So we have written the whole equation. So this is like, if you see this equation, we can write down over here that W max is something like which is equal to going from 1 to 0. Don't consider this to be a mathematical one, it is just for understanding purpose, and state 2 to going to state 0. So ultimately we will be going from 1 to 2 in this equation. We have simply utilized the availability function. So finally by rearranging the terms and deleting few terms, we will be getting this. That is, W max is equal to H1 minus H2 minus T0 S1 minus H2 plus V1 square minus V2 square by 2 plus G Z1 minus Z2. And if kinetic energy and potential energy terms are neglected, we can simply write down W max is equal to H1 minus T0 S1 minus H2 minus T0 S2. And if you recall, H minus T0 S is equal to B, where B is Kinon function. Now our next theory is availability in a non-flow process. Let us consider a closed system and denote its initial state by parameters without any subscript and the final dead state with subscript 0. The availability of a system A, that is maximum useful work obtainable as the system reaches the dead state, is given by this formula, that is A is equal to WU max is equal to E minus E0 plus P0V minus V0 minus T0S minus S0. We have already studied this formula. So instead of E here, instead of E, we have written U plus mv square by 2 plus mgz, and similarly we have written for E0, that is U0 plus mgz0, and again at the dead state as the velocity is 0, that's why the kinetic energy term is not present over here. Now if kinetic energy and potential energy changes are neglected and for unit mass, the availability becomes A is equal to U minus U0 plus P0 V minus V0 minus T0 S minus S0. So again, rearranging these terms, we have this formula. That is, we have collected U plus PV minus TS together, and this is known as A is equal to phi minus phi 0 here. And what is phi here? Phi is the availability function for a closed system. Now let us say, so here what we were doing, again this whole discussion that we have done is going from some particular state to a dead state. And now what we are going to do is from state 1 to 2. Now A is equal to phi 1 minus phi 0. Again, we have done this similar kind of stuff in our previous theory, so we are doing the same here. That if we are going from state 1 to state 2, the decrease in availability is given by availability is equal to phi 1 minus phi 0 minus phi 2 minus phi 0, and finally we are getting A is equal to phi 1 minus phi 2. So we are getting A is U1 minus U2 plus P0 V1 minus V2 minus T0 S1 minus S2. This is the maximum work obtainable under the given surrounding condition. So this will be our maximum work obtainable. Now our next theory is availability in chemical reactions. So let's begin. In many chemical reactions, the reactants are often in pressure and temperature equilibrium with the surroundings, and so are the products after the reactions. So what they are trying to say that here we are having, in a particular chemical process, we are having reactants and based on that we are getting the products. So at the beginning of the process, the reactants will be at surrounding conditions, that is in pressure and temperature equilibrium, as well as the products after the reactions will also be in pressure and temperature equilibrium. Let us take an example of an IC engine in which if we visualize the products being cooled to atmospheric temperature T0 before being from the engine. So now we are going to discuss this availability in chemical reactions in two different parts. So let's begin here. Let us first consider a system in which is in temperature equilibrium with the surroundings before and after the process. And the maximum work obtainable during the change of state is given by this formula, that is W max is equal to E1 minus E2 minus T0 S1 minus S2. That is, we have already done this formula. So again, the W max is replaced with this, that is U1 plus MV1 square by 2 plus MgZ1 minus the similar kind of terms minus T0 S1 minus S2. Now again, if the kinetic energy and potential energy terms are, let us say, if they are neglected, then we can so here finally, after neglecting the kinetic energy and potential energy terms, we have obtained this formula, that is W max is equal to U1 minus U2 minus T0 S1 minus S2. Since initial and final temperatures of the system are same as that of surrounding, that is T1 is equal to T2 is equal to T0, let us say equal to T, then we can write down this formula, that is WT max is equal to U1 minus U2 at T minus T S1 minus S2 at T. Now this property is known as Helmholtz function F, which is defined by this relation, that is F is equal to U minus TS. So we need to remember this very well, that Helmholtz function is U minus T0, and if you recall our Keenan function was H minus T0S. Now for two equilibrium states 1 and 2 at the same temperature T is given by this formula, that F1 minus F2 at T is equal to U1 minus U2 at T minus T S1 minus S2 at T. Now WT max, that is this formula, if you see, so this entire formula is written in terms of difference of Helmholtz function. And obviously if WT max is equal to F1 minus F2 at T, the actual WT will be less than or equal to F1 minus F2 at T. Now as you can see from this equation, if we write down this in words, then work done by a system in any process between two equilibrium states at the same temperature, during which the system exchanges only heat with equilibrium, is equal to or less than, if you see, if you focus on this portion, is equal to or less than the decrease in the Helmholtz function during the process. So this work done by the system is equal to or less than decrease in the Helmholtz function during the process, and the maximum work is done when the process is reversible and equality sign holds. So this equation, if you see, this equation is applicable for reversible process, and this equation is true for irreversible process. Okay, if the process is irreversible, then work is less than the maximum one. That is quite obvious. Now we are at the part 2 of this theory. So let us now consider a system in which in both pressure and temperature equilibrium are present with the surrounding before and after the process. So if you compare both the parts, in previous part we were only having the temperature equilibrium, now we are discussing equilibrium of pressure and temperature both. When the volume of the system increases, some work is done by a system against the surroundings, that is PdV work. And this is not available for doing useful work. So this work, that is the work which is done by the system against the surrounding, is not available for doing any kind of useful work. Now the availability of the system that is neglecting the kinetic and potential energy changes can be expressed in this form that we have already seen, that is availability is equal to Wt max is equal to u plus p0v minus t0s minus the same terms at the dead state. So A can be written as phi minus phi 0, and obviously this is our availability function. The maximum work obtainable during a change of state is the decrease in availability of the system. So we can write down in this way that Wt max can also be written as A1 minus A2, that is equal to the availability function phi 1 minus phi 2. So Wt max is equal to, again we have rearranged this, so we have written this in different way with subscript 1 and 2. Previously it was without subscript and zero subscript, now it is between state 1 and state 2. So Wt max is equal to u1 minus u2 plus p0 v1 minus v2 minus t0 s1 minus s2. If the initial and final equilibrium states of the system are at same pressure and temperature of the surroundings, we can write down P1 equal to P2 equal to P0 is equal to, let us say, P, and T1 is equal to T2 is equal to T0, let us say, equal to T. So Wt max can be also written in this way. So we have modified this equation slightly with the same pressure and temperature for initial and final equilibrium states. So this is known as Gibbs function, G, which is H minus Ts. This is known as Gibbs function in this case, where it can also be written as G is equal to U plus PV minus Ts. Now for two equilibrium states at same pressure P and temperature T, we can say that the difference in Gibbs function is given by this formula, that is U1 minus U2 plus P into V1 minus V2 minus T S1 minus S2. So Wu max is given by G1 minus G2 at the same pressure and temperature, and obviously the Wu will be less than or equal to G1 minus G2 Pt. Now here obviously the decrease in Gibbs function of the system sets an upper limit to a work that can be performed, and this is exclusive of PdV work, which is not counted in any process between two equilibrium states at the same pressure and temperature, provided the system exchanges heat only with the environment, which is at the same pressure and temperature at the end states of the system. And here, if the process is irreversible, the useful work will be less than the maximum. So the first is for reversible, and second equation is for irreversible. Now the next is irreversibility, or Gauss-Todola theorem that we are going to discuss now. Is here the actual work done by a system is always less than the idealized reversible work, that is obvious, and this difference between these two is known as irreversibility of the process that we have studied during the entropy chapter also. So I, that is irreversibility, is W max minus W, and this is sometimes referred to as degradation or dissipation. दिस इज नोन एज डिग्रेडेशन और डिसिपेशन. Now, for a non-flow process between the equilibrium states, when the system exchanges heat only with the environment, we can write down this formula. That is, this is our maximum work that can be obtainable minus this is the actual work. Okay. So if you recall, this is this term is based on the first law of thermodynamics, that is the value of W. Now if you see, after slight modification and elimination of few terms, you can say I is equal to T0 S2 minus S1 minus Q. So here we can write down this, that T0 into delta S system, that is for the first term, minus for Q we can write down this, that T0 delta S surrounding. So when we combine them, so if you see, this term is applicable for here, and here the second term is this. Q is minus Q is T0 delta S surrounding. So finally we are getting T0 delta S system plus T delta S surrounding, and T0 is delta S universe. So finally we can say that I is greater than or equal to 0 based on the increase of entropy principle, that delta S universe will always be greater than or equal to 0. Similarly, for a steady flow process, we can write down this, I is equal to W max minus W, and instead of W max we can write down this. And for W we can write down this. So T0 S2 minus S1 minus Q. This can also be written in this way. So here the same formula is applied over here. Here the only thing you should remember, that here we will be putting H1 minus T0 S1, and here we are putting H2 minus T0 S2. So finally, when you eliminate these terms, this all terms will get eliminated. Sorry, H1 will be later on eliminated. This all will get eliminated, and here H1 will get eliminated with this. So H1 will get eliminated with this H1, and this H2 will get eliminated with this H2. That's why upon simplification we will be getting this. Okay. So finally what we are getting is T0 delta S universe. The same expression for irreversibility applies for both flow and non-flow processes. We have seen this with our two examples. And the quantity T0 delta S system plus delta S surrounding represents the increase in unavailable energy. The Goy-Stodula theorem that states that the rate of loss of availability or exergy in a process is proportional to the rate of entropy generation, S dot generation. So here, I dot is equal to W lost dot is equal to T0 delta S universe, which is equal to T0 S generation. And this is known as Goy-Stodola equation. A thermodynamically efficient process would involve minimum exergy loss with minimum rate of entropy generation. So that is also one way we can write down the Goy-Stodola equation's implication. Now our next theory is applications of Goy-Stodola equation. So let's begin. First is heat transfer through a finite temperature difference. So here we are having a heat transfer between a finite temperature difference T1 and T2. And here between T1 and T2, in the second case, we will be running a heat engine and the work will be dissipated in this break, and again it is going into the reservoir T2. So here, if the heat transfer occurs, that is Q dot from hot reservoir at temperature T1 to a cold reservoir temperature T2 is this. So here S generation is given by Q dot upon T2 minus Q dot upon T1. So finally we are getting Q dot S T1 minus T2 upon T1 T2. So this equation is applicable for first figure. And here in case of W lost, suppose if we are running this heat engine, then W lost is given by Q dot 1 minus T2 by T1. So Q dot is T1 minus T2 by T1. So when we combine these two equations, we can say that W lost is equal to T2 into S generation, that is where we are rejecting the heat temperature, where we are rejecting the heat into S generation. Here, if the heat transfer Q dot from T1 to T2 takes place through a reversible heat engine E, that is shown over here, the entire work output W is now dissipated in the break, that is over here. Here we are dissipating the entire work. From which equal amount of heat is rejected to the reservoir T2. Heat transfer through a finite temperature difference is equivalent to destruction of availability. Now our next application is flow with friction. So here let us consider a steady and adiabatic flow of a gas through a segment of pipe, that is over here. By first law, we can say that H1 is equal to H2 because the other terms are same at two sections. Or you can say this is also one way we can write down the steady flow energy equation also. Now by second law, we can say that TdS is equal to dH minus VdP. This is also done in our previous lectures. So what we have done over here is that we have written this, integrated this, and we have written in this way. And as this term, if you see, the first integration term that is over here is 0, because based on the first law h1 is equal to h2. So this green highlighted term will be 0, so we are only left with minus integration of v upon t dp. And here s generation is given by integration 1 to 2 mds. So here instead of this ds we have written this. Now you need to be very careful about this simplification that is done over here. Let us say that we are writing down PV equal to RT. So what we can do here is implies that V upon T is equal to R upon P. So what we can do here, that we can further write down this equation as minus integration 1 to 2 is given by R upon P into dP. So if you see what we have done here is for this integration of dS we can put this. Okay, so instead of this ds we have simply put this r dp upon p. And now after integration we can get this, that is the integration of 1 upon p dp is ln p2 by p1. Now here it is written in this way, minus mr ln 1 minus delta p upon p1. This is also very easy. Why? Because let us say that delta p, if you put this p2 minus p1, and if you simplify this term, then you will be easily getting that answer. Okay, so this is also easy. You can do it by yourself. Based on putting delta P as difference between two pressures, you will be getting this. And now, here, instead of this term, that is blue highlighted term, that is logarithmic of 1 minus delta P over P1, if we expand this we can simply write down directly delta P upon minus of delta P upon P1. Okay, so finally what we are getting is plus MR delta P upon P1. And W lost again, if we recall, is given by B1 minus B2. So we can write down in this way that m dot is h1 minus t0 s1 minus h2 minus t0 s2. So here again this is h1 minus h2, h1 equal to h2, so this will not be this will get cancelled and we are getting this. So this is t0 into s generation, where s generation is given by mr into, so if you see this is again utilized over here for S generation. Okay, so this is the value we are getting for this total delta S, that is sorry, for W lost. So this is the value of W lost we are getting. So the decrease in availability or lost work is proportional to the decrease in availability or lost work is proportional to pressure drop and unit and mass flow rate. It is also shown over here in Grassmann's diagram. If you see that this is the Keenan function value which is entering and it is being reduced with W lost. Now our next theory is mixing of two fluids. So let's first copy these figures. And now apply let's apply the Gauss total here. So here, as you can see, this is mixing of two streams, that is M1 and M2 are getting mixed, and they are together they are becoming M3. So let's write down the formulas that M1 dot plus M2 dot is equal to M3, as you can see very well from the figure also, which is equal to M. Okay, let us see. Now let us have a fraction, defining a fraction just like dryness fraction that we are having. Let us say MX is equal to M1 dot divided by M1 dot plus M2 dot. So here, by first law of thermodynamics, what we can say, if you see this figure, then with first law, what we can write down? We can write down that M1 dot into H1 plus M2 dot H2 is equal to M into H. H3 we can say, or M3, H3 we can write down. Now here, instead of M1, we can write down X into M3 dot H1 plus, now instead of we will define one more term over here. We have defined fraction, so let us calculate also 1 minus x. And if you calculate this 1 minus x by yourself while putting this formula, you will be getting over here as M2 dot over M1 dot plus M2 dot. So instead of M2, what we can write down is 1 minus x into M3 into H2, which is equal to M3 into H3. So finally, what we are getting over here is X into H1 plus 1 minus X into H2, which is equal to H3. And as enthalpy is only a function of temperature, we can write down X into T1 plus 1 minus X H, sorry, it should be T2. Equal to T3. So this is the value we are getting, and we can also slightly modify this again, that T3 by T1 is equal to X plus 1 minus X into T2 by T1. So here, finally, what we are getting is the value of, these are all mathematical steps, you can easily understand, X plus 1 minus X into tau. Where here, comma, the value of tau is equal to T2 by T1. So this is the value that we are getting here. Now this is the whole thing which we have done is based on the first law. Now we will be applying the second law. So here for the second law, what we are going to do is S generation which is given by M3 dot S3 minus M1 dot S1 minus M2 dot S2. So here we are getting M3 dot S3 for here we will be getting X into M3 dot S1 minus 1 minus X into M3 dot S2. So here this is the value of S generation dot. So S generation dot can also be written as divided by M3, or we can simply say M dot. So S3 minus X S1 minus 1 minus X S2. So here what we are getting is, if you further simplify this, then this will be S3 minus S2 my plus X into S2 minus S1. And further if we write down, this will be Cp ln T3 by T2 plus X ln X into Cp ln T2 by T1. So now I will be writing only S generation upon M. I will not write down M3 now. So here S generation upon M dot Cp is equal to ln T3 by T2 into T2 by T1 raised to X. So here if we this will be written as NS, that we will discuss later on, that NS is equal to ln of T3 by T1 into T1 by T2 raised to 1 minus X. So this is just some mathematical adjustments of powers that we have done over here, that you should do it by yourself. So here what we are getting is now, which is equal to ln into T3 by T1 over T2 by T1 raised to 1 minus X. So we are done with today's lecture. What we will do is we will continue from here in our next lecture, as well as what we will do is we will revise this portion also. So let me first copy this portion. So now it is better. We will continue this portion again in our next lecture. However, let me finish this part again. It will only take 1 or 2 minutes now. So here, if we move further, then we can write down this T3 instead of T3 by T1, that is here, instead of T3 by T1 we can write down this x plus 1 plus minus x into tau. So let us write down this, that this is ln x plus 1 minus x into tau divided by this is also tau into 1 minus x, and this is the value of ns, which is known as entropy generation number, which is given by this formula as generation divided by mct. And here we can also write down the value of w lost work, which is equal to I dot, which is equal to T0 into MCP ln x plus tau into 1 minus x divided by tau raised to 1 minus x. So this is the value of lost work. We will discuss this portion again in our next lecture. This is the end of today's lecture. Thank you for watching this video.